I'm a tourist today. I've taken part in a tour called Norway in a Nutshell. And we are, of course, in Bergen. It's very famous for its fjords. And over there is the ship that we will be taking to go around and see the area. It's really pretty. Colors are nice. It's almost the beginning of autumn, and I'm excited. That is a fantastic view, isn't it? Bergen is one of the bigger cities in Norway, but as you can see, the development of the city itself with all the different wharves, the buildings and the residential areas are all in harmony with nature. You can see the hills over there. The trees are all intact and it's just a very pretty city, and look, the lights have gone on. The gorgeous city of Tromsø is our next stop before we head way north, deep into the Arctic, to see how climate change is manifesting there. I was interested to learn what young people think about this issue, especially students who also do research about the natural environment. So we visited the University of Tromsø. What's good to eat? All right. Hi.
Hello.
I'm finally here.
Ida and I are writing our thesis. Pierre is doing a bit of lab work. After his working up some extra.
Just to finish the whole project, right?
I've been working a lot in a cold room.
Cold room.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had like different batches of water. With the Calanus glacialis, with this small plankton.
How do you feel that the effects are being felt now, and maybe in our lifetime there might be some huge changes that we see in the environment?
I think we're all very concerned as the young generation, and I think now that we're becoming adults, we realize that it's our turn to step up and to maybe involve ourselves in politics and take a stand, especially since we're educated in the field of environmental sciences, and most of us are studying the effects of climate change or of human activity.
Then you can also change little things about your habits, you know, like for instance just turning the light off when you're leaving a room.
Maybe it starts here, you know, like...
Yeah, just little things that can make, I think, a great change if everyone does.
We couldn't leave Tromsø without visiting a key institution that's been doing crucial work in the Arctic. We're here at the Norwegian Polar Institute, and I'm going to meet Director Jan-Gunnar and ask about their research and what their findings are in terms of climate change.
Hello.
Hi, Director.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for taking the time.
We had this spectacular expedition up in the Arctic Ocean this winter. We froze in our research vessel into the pack ice, the sea ice, and just left her there, moving around with the winds and the currents for half a year. Well, in this area you have more or less 4 months total darkness, and you have 4 months with total sunshine. Yeah. Here's our research vessel. This is January, and you can see surrounded by sea ice. And of course, in these pictures, nothing really reminds us about warming and climate change. It's cold and dark in the deep Arctic in the winter. But even so, the changes are dramatic, and no region in the world changes so fast as the Arctic. We thought that Arctic climate change was a regional issue. But now we learn more and more that we have these teleconnections. So what happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic. It affects the whole Northern Hemisphere and other regions of the world.
Ready?
Yep.
Ready. Yeah, okay, please.
Thank you.
I used a lot of my time and energy to have discussion, convince people, and also having the discussions in the media and so on about, is this real?
Yeah.
That phase is, in my opinion, past.
Yeah.
The evidence is so strong that we should use our energy in solving it.
Yes.
And adapting also.
Director, tell us the story from the beginning, if there were a beginning to this story.
The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has, in its last report, made very clear statements about the strong evidence that we have a human-induced climate change. So the world is warming, and at a pace that is unknown to us for a long, long time. And then, in this global warming, we have the region of the Arctic that now warms at least twice as fast as the global average. This warming in the Arctic is not staying in the Arctic. It has, through the atmosphere and the ocean, it kind of gives effect also outside that Arctic region. This is a very young discipline of research, so there are lots of unknowns, but there are more and more hypotheses. And indications, I should say, although science is not agreeing totally on this, that we have teleconnections, which means that when the Arctic changes, the sea ice in the Arctic melts, it affects other things in the world, like the monsoon. The timing of the monsoon, the duration of the monsoon, also the location of it, where it finds its way. And extreme weather is another one. I did my PhD in Svalbard 25 years ago. When I go back to Svalbard now, I can visually see the changes. I see it, there is no sea ice, the glaciers are shrinking, they are way less than they used to be. So it's within a 30-year period, it's not only measurable, it's visually you can see it. And this is quite exceptional, I think. But then we have seen, unfortunately, that Greenland started to respond.
Also.
Yeah, and it's now feeding the world's ocean with fresh water. Mm. Antarctica, a bit later, but also is now positive in the negative sense. It's positively losing mass. And Greenland and Antarctica together are now more important today than all the rest of the glaciers around the world. And this is a bit worrying because Greenland and Antarctica are so big. For Philippines, based on what we know today, the sea level is
the biggest problem.
It is a problem that you can't get around. It will happen.
How do you convince people to actually move when on a daily basis they see that the ocean doesn't seem to change?
Many have asked themselves exactly that.
Yeah.
And we thought for a while, many of the scientists, that when you get these dramatic, extreme things like Katrina, like the flood in Pakistan, like yours,
Uganda, yeah, like
yeah. Mm-hmm. That will kick in.
Yeah.
But apparently, it looks like we have a tendency to forget.
Yes, we do.
We want to forget. It's easier to forget, we think. But it's not responsible, and it's not smart. And it seems like to be a kind of a characteristics of human beings that we hope so strongly that things will be back to normal, or they will be better, they will improve. We build our building at the same place where it was destroyed.
Yes.
Last year.
Is it optimism, maybe? Or naivety?
I don't know, but it happens over and over again. Yeah. Out in the cooler air. Yeah. It's not easy to tackle it because it's a global issue and all of us need to contribute. How that is done, that's difficult. Yeah. But not tackling the problem is really a bad alternative.
It's not an option.
It's not really a good option, no.
Right, right. It's always an option, but it's
To find out about the impact of climate change in Svalbard, we scheduled a meeting with Guri from the Environment Department. The picture she painted about the future of Svalbard wasn't very pretty.